Energy and the City. Lynn Babcock, Associate Professor of Environmental Health and Engineering, University of Illinois in Chicago.
Hello again. I suppose you're wondering why I came bicycling into the studio. I guess I am too. Anyway, the topic today is energy, and the bicycle is a very efficient energy use, as you will see. During the preceding lecture, I discussed some of the urban patterns and forces which have been defined and which help to describe the nation's cities. There's another important parameter which is not often considered by either the land use planner or the urban geographer. Yet in some ways, it's the most controlling factor. Yes, I'm speaking of energy. Energy use is the dominant cause of air pollution and is also the means by which man has been able to free himself from muscle labor. Without fossil fuels and other plentiful and low-cost energy resources, cities would be very different than they are today. There would be no massive industries, no tall buildings, no distant suburbs. There would be no cars, no buses, no trucks, no airplanes. It sounds pretty good, doesn't it? But there'd be no warm homes either, and so on. There would be a much smaller population and little affluence or prosperity. There also would be no air pollution. Thus, the urban energy system should be a prime consideration of the ACLM. The urban system as we now know it could not function without energy. Energy is the key to our urbanized prosperity as well as to environmental problems. Of course, the ACLM could separately consider industry, housing, transportation, affluence, air pollution, and so on without being overly concerned with energy. But it seems to us that energy parameters are a most useful way of relating diverse aspects of the urban system with air pollution. In fact, there are several reasons why the ACLM should make energy considerations an integral part of his strategies. First, energy processes generate air pollution directly. Reductions in energy use cause concurrent reductions in air pollution. Second, energy conservation can be beneficially practiced along with optimization of the supply-consumption system. The goal here is to make the most efficient, most environmentally appropriate, best use of the cleanest fuels. Perhaps most important, the air quality management strategy must be made compatible with fuel availability situation. The energy crisis which confronts us today is compounded by control devices and strategies which increase total energy use, and especially the use of certain fuels which are in short supply. The President took an inevitable step in April 1973 when he pleaded for relaxation of certain emission standards in order to enable continued use of high sulfur coal rather than scarcer liquid and gaseous fuels. Such agonizing reappraisals tend to lessen public support for all environmental control programs. Energy, its use and misuse is an environmental problem in itself. Perhaps in the long run, energy conservation will become a more significant environmental issue than air pollution. In the United States, we're responsible for 35% of the world's annual energy consumption, even though we represent only 6% of the world's population. Obviously, difficulties lie ahead as industrializing countries compete with each other and with us for the ever-diminishing supplies. The Aklum can thus serve a dual purpose, since his efforts to use energy wisely and more efficiently would help conserve the supply and at the same time would contribute to improved air quality. We hope you agree that energy deserves a lecture in our series, and here it is. By the way, this is our only X-rated lecture, so watch closely. Well, just how much energy do we use? In 1970, it was 70 quadrillion BTUs, a number so large that it's difficult to extract any meaning from it. As you know, a BTU is the amount of energy required to raise the temperature of 1 pound of water 1 degree Fahrenheit. The BTU is a small unit of energy. Heating 1 cup of water from 32 degrees Fahrenheit to its boiling point at 212 would require 90 BTUs. An average American car requires approximately 10,000 BTUs per mile. Trucks and buses use 2 to 3 times as much energy per mile. A Boeing 747 uses 60 times as much energy per mile as an automobile. A portable air conditioner each hour can use energy equivalent to 1 mile distance with your car. A woman taking a bath might use 30,000 BTUs, equivalent to 3 automobile miles. The John Hancock Center here in Chicago uses 8.5 million BTUs per hour, equivalent to 850 automobile miles. We will use the BTU unit from time to time during this lecture, even though it isn't a very satisfactory measure of large amounts of energy. Perhaps it's useful to think of the 770 quadrillion BTU, our annual national usage, as the continuous output of 300 large 100,000 barrel per day oil refineries, or the continuous output of over 2,000 very large 1,000 megawatt electric power plants. When we look at energy in these terms, the enormous environmental implications are more apparent. On a per capita basis, our energy consumption is equivalent to 7 gallons of gasoline each day. That's not per family, but per person, each and every day. To make matters worse, the demand for energy is continuing to increase rapidly. If present trends continue, the demand is going to double by 1985 and triple by the year 2000. Those units are quadrillion BTUs on the ordinate. Now let's move from consideration of demand to supply. We don't process all our energy in oil refineries and electric power plants, but coal, natural gas, petroleum products are the major sources of energy use at the present time. These fuels also constitute the major sources of air pollution. Together, these fossil fuels supply over 98% of our energy demand. Hydroelectric energy and fast-growing nuclear energy comprise the remaining 2%. It's important for us to realize that when we use the coal, oil, and gas, nuclear fuel, that the consumption is primarily at the expense of what we might call energy capital, rather than out of continuous income. It takes millions of years to form fossil fuel reserves, but these can be consumed in a relatively short time period. As in everyday life, capital is hard to build up, but easy to spend. Someday, clean, plentiful energy alternatives may be available. Direct use of nature's abundant and free solar radiation sounds like the best answer from an environmental standpoint. Unfortunately, it may be some time, if ever, before solar cells or some other innovation solves the world's energy needs. In the meantime, energy demand is expected to rise faster than supply. The result will be the so-called energy gap. At least there's a gap shown here. But forecasting the future energy situation is risky since it's impossible to correctly consider all the interacting important factors, such as variations in price, availability of resources, environmental constraints, the impact of new technology, efficiency in production and use, new governmental policies, the potential for reducing demand, and so on. It may not provide much comfort, but I predict that there'll be no energy gap and that the world will never run out of fossil fuel reserves. Well, why? Because our economist friends tell us that eventually, despite attempts at regulation, changes in price will make supply equal to demand. That is, higher prices will probably increase the supply and at the same time will tend to reduce demand. Higher prices seem inevitable unless some innovation remarkably increases the supply in the near future. The Aklum can't solve the energy supply problem. In fact, he may greet higher prices with a degree of professional pleasure. Within the urban system, higher prices would reduce energy use and the concurrent emission of energy-related air pollutants. The Aklum's responsibility and opportunity seem to be to try to ease this transition from plentiful, low-cost energy supplies of the past to a higher cost framework of the future. He should work to provide non-polluting alternatives, which should automatically result in reduced energy consumption. And that's all without undue hardship for the population. In a few minutes, we'll delve into the urban energy system to see how and where the Aklum might reduce energy demand. But first, let's address the concept of energy efficiency. Efficiency can be defined simply as useful output divided by total input. Quite obviously, improved efficiency could help conserve energy resources and at the same time improve air quality. Much energy is wasted. Not only does our nation use more energy, it wastes more. The overall efficiency of the nation's energy system is roughly 50%, and this efficiency is decreasing each year. We annually waste 35 quadrillion BTU. That's more than any other country uses. When describing efficiency, it's important to differentiate between various kinds. Both application and conversion efficiency, application and conversion of energy contribute to decreases in overall efficiency. Consider a 50-gallon tank for heating water. Let's compare the overall total efficiencies of two alternative systems, one in which the tank is heated electrically and the other with the tank heated with a direct gas flame. For both alternatives, let's assume that the basic source of energy is natural gas. Let's also assume that 62,500 BTU are required to heat the water. With a high application efficiency of 95%, the electric unit will require an input of 66,000 BTUs. Almost all of the electrical energy is transmitted directly to the water. The gas-fired alternative has a much lower application efficiency since a considerable fraction of the heat leaves through the flue vent pipe. The application efficiency here is only 62.5%. Thus, 100,000 BTUs input are required to heat the water versus only 66,000 for the electricity alternative. But application efficiency is only part of the story. Conversion efficiency also must be considered, and processes for making electricity from heat are particularly inefficient. We don't have time to delve into a thermodynamic explanation here, but the nationwide fossil fuel to electricity conversion efficiency is only about 33%. Two BTUs are wasted in order to produce one useful BTU of electricity. Thus, in order to produce the output of 66,000 BTU needed to heat the water in our electric example, we must supply instead a gas input of 200,000 BTUs. Thus, the electric heating system looks a good deal less attractive when the conversion efficiency is considered. Twice as much energy is required for the electric alternative, even though the electric alternative has a much higher application efficiency. The ACLM should think twice before suggesting use of electricity for heating. Our example indicates that the conversion of heat to electricity and back to heat is particularly inefficient. Increased use of electricity in the nation is the prime cause of our continuing efficiency decrease of overall energy use. The ACLM should be wary of grandiose all-electric urban designs as long as electricity is derived inefficiently from fossil fuels. Note that our comparison has ignored transmission efficiency, which is an additional important consideration. Energy is required to force electricity through wires, just as energy is required to pump gas through pipes. For our comparison, however, it isn't unreasonable to assume that such losses are equal for both gas and electricity. For long distances, transmission losses can consume a major portion of the total energy. So remote power plants, then, aren't always the answer. Before leaving the electric power question, let's note how attractive electric processes could become if we could just either increase the conversion efficiency, or alternatively, if we could utilize a significant portion of the waste heat which is now added to our water or air environment. This waste heat is a serious environmental problem in itself. There remains still another efficiency concept which is important to the ACLM. This one we call utilization effectiveness. For example, an urban bus, fuel-wise, might require 40,000 BTUs per mile of operation, while an average American automobile might require only 10,000 BTUs per mile. So, neglecting the drivers, a bus with 8 passengers is equivalent to an automobile with 2 passengers. Both alternatives would use energy at the rate of roughly 5,000 BTUs per passenger mile. The ACLM must consider utilization as well as efficiency. A large empty bus is no bargain, energy-wise or pollution-wise. Well, enough for the background. Now that the ACLM is armed with efficiency and utilization parameters, let's see where he can apply them. 4 major categories are shown in this distribution of energy use. Let's consider the role of the ACLM as we address each category individually. Some of the energy use is generally beyond the influence of the ACLM. Industry, for example, is the largest consumption category. The overall efficiency of industrial energy use, like that for the nation as a whole, is roughly 50%. Pricing policies, rather than the ACLM, will have the greatest effect on this category. From the ACLM standpoint, the pricing system is all wrong because the largest users pay the lowest rates. The ACLM probably questions industrial motives and procedures, but he should recognize that the profit motive ensures that industries, at least the successful ones, will place high emphasis on cost-benefit analysis. When energy is cheap, industry may tend, in a sense, to waste it. When energy becomes more expensive, industry will reorient its policies and will institute energy conservation programs as long as they save the company money. Recent increases in energy prices are causing industrial managers to take another look at their energy costs. An important trade-off here is that between energy and labor costs. But let's not extend the argument to imply that high energy costs would tend to reduce unemployment. In fact, the converse seems to be true up to now. Energy use seems to create more jobs than it takes away. Certain industries are enormous users of energy, and they can be extremely cost-conscious. Oil refineries, for example, consume almost 9% of the industrial total. Their conversion efficiency, that is, crude oil into products, is roughly 85%, And each gallon of crude oil which is consumed in the refinery is a gallon which does not become a saleable product. Oil companies, maybe because they're in the energy business, are extremely energy conscious and have instituted sophisticated and expensive, but still profit-making, energy recovery and recycling processes. This seems as good a time as any to point out that although energy companies are quite cost-conscious with regard to internal energy use, they still are governed by the profit motive with regard to external product sales. The business prospers when sales increase. Steel companies are not energy companies, but they provide an interesting example of industrial energy conservation. They're often rightfully accused of high emissions from several of their steel-making processes. Yet the off-gases from blast furnaces are cleaned to an extremely low particulate level. Not because steel companies have any special altruism or love for the alkaline, but because these off-gases have a high heat content due to high concentrations of carbon monoxide. These gases are recovered and used as fuel. The particulate matter is almost completely removed in order to prevent fouling and wear of burner orifices. The blast furnace procedure is an excellent example of energy conservation causing concurrent improvement in air quality. Energy is recovered and neither the particulate matter nor the carbon monoxide reaches the atmosphere. The alkaline is often not so fortunate. For some processes, more than 10% of the electrical usage in a plant is expended for emission control equipment. High energy scrubbers have particularly high energy requirements. A non-industrial example of this conflict between energy conservation and clean air involves emission control devices for automobiles, which cause reduced rather than increased fuel economy. Finally, it should be noted that when an industry makes electric power for captive use, it will almost always utilize the waste heat. In fact, unless purchased electric power is extremely expensive, the industry will not find it cost-effective to manufacture its own electric power. That is, unless that industry does have a concurrent use for the waste heat. In some situations, the electricity can even be the byproduct of the process heat use. As I mentioned earlier, the alkaline often can't do much about reducing industrial energy use. When he thinks of industry, he usually thinks of requiring control equipment and of citing industry with regard to minimizing pollution effects by optimizing source receptor geometry. But there can be more to industrial siting. The alkaline can encourage this concurrent heat electricity utilization, not just within a single plant, but between separate plants. To be feasible, the plant using the waste heat must be located close to, say within a mile of, the electric power plant. This need for close proximity tends to indicate that present-day waste heat utilization schemes would most likely involve industrial rather than widespread residential use. Each time the alkaline can create a joint energy utilization situation, he eliminates a fuel-burning boiler. He eliminates the thermal pollution problem. And he makes electricity a much more efficient energy source, one which might replace, for example, a multitude of low-efficiency, highly polluting residential coal furnaces in the inner city. Enough for industry. Let's move next to residential and commercial use. I will consider these similar categories together. Together, they account for 35% of the nation's energy demand, slightly less than that for industry. Energy use in both categories is largely for heating and air conditioning. Space heating, the major use category, is responsible for more than 50% of the total in the residential commercial sector. Therefore, not surprisingly, space heating is also identified as the end use where the largest energy savings could be realized. A recent study has shown that with optimum use of insulation, storm windows, and so on, energy consumption for space heating in a gas-heated home could be reduced by up to 30%. Each BTU of gas thus saved can be applied elsewhere, hopefully as a replacement for urban coal use. Well-insulated buildings also have lower air conditioning costs, but permanently sealed windows can be a minus as far as air conditioning costs are concerned. On many days, the air conditioning would not be necessary if the windows could be opened. Likewise, commercial buildings could be more optimally designed. The popular aluminum glass exteriors of skyscrapers can waste large amounts of energy used either for heating or for cooling. Water heating is also a significant energy use. Energy conservation is possible here also. The Aklum, moving on to a new topic, the Aklum might suggest a cost-benefit analysis to prove the greater economy of better insulation and of other energy conservation measures. Unfortunately, with today's prices, the cost-benefit analysis often results in a standoff. For the homeowner with a gas furnace, the amortized costs of insulation and so on are just about equivalent to the savings in fuel. At today's prices, that is. Expected higher prices would change the economics. Such presently is the situation when electricity, a high-priced energy source, is used to heat homes. In this case, proper insulation not only saves energy, but reduces overall combined heating and insulating costs by up to one-third. Maybe today's the day. Thus, one of the Aklum's major weapons, again, is energy pricing. High energy prices help assure energy conservation. Unfortunately, the homeowner and the architect don't seem as energy and cost conscious as the industrialist. For example, some air conditioners can supply twice as much cooling with the same input energy requirements. Air conditioning energy could be reduced by 50%. Yet sales of the less efficient units remain high, probably because they cost less initially. Then there are easy energy savings to be obtained by lowering thermostat levels in winter and raising them in summer, by turning off the lights, by use of fluorescent light. Fluorescent lights save energy directly, and in summer they also reduce air conditioning loads. But yes, they do cost more initially. Energy conservation through improved building design and operation will no doubt increase as energy prices increase. An interesting, more immediate alternative might be to take a look at building codes, to revise them now to include energy conservation considerations. While some of the foregoing seems to have departed considerably from land use, I apologize. In fact, we have spent several months, largely unsuccessfully, trying to identify ways in which buildings could be sited so as to significantly reduce energy use. Yes, trees help in both summer and winter. And yes, in cold climates, buildings and their windows can be oriented to get maximum winter sun and minimum northwesterly winds. Vice versa in summer, where air conditioning is the prime consideration. But these options just don't seem to save significant amounts of energy, particularly for buildings in temperate climates, which require both heating and cooling. More studies into such questions should be undertaken. There is one firm conclusion, and that has to do with multiple dwelling buildings. Their energy requirements per unit for heating and cooling are much less than for single-family dwellings, simply because there are fewer outside walls, fewer outside ceilings, and outside floors. Shared facilities and utilities further reduce energy consumption per dwelling unit. One of our back-of-an-envelope calculations indicated that despite the energy required for elevators and pumping costs, a building could rise to a height of 80 stories before energy requirements per dwelling unit would exceed those for a normally constructed single-family home. Now that's a comforting conclusion for those of us who prefer to live in high-rise buildings. It's somewhat disconcerting if you prefer that single-family house in the suburbs. This isn't to say that a single-family house couldn't be designed to be as efficient as a multiple-family building, but the construction costs would be very high. Other pros and cons related to high-density living will arise during our sixth lecture. Well, I've saved the best, or at least the most important, until last. Transportation is the second largest energy use category and is the category which can be most directly influenced by the ACLM. There seem to be at least two options. First, he should attempt to reduce the overall amount of transportation required in a region. He can do this by minimizing travel distances. Second, the ACLM should strive toward situations where lower energy or low pollution modes would preferentially replace present modes of travel. Before embarking on either or both courses of alteration, it seems important that the ACLM first have some understanding of how, why, and where people travel within an urban region. Modern intra-urban travel involves a number of modes, including the suburban railroad, rapid transit, buses, automobiles, trucks, taxis, bicycles, and yes, some people are still walking. A number of factors influence the choice between these modes. Predictability of reaching the destination on time, comfort, cost, travel time, waiting time, and so on are some of the considerations. Most of these factors presently favor the private automobile. As a result, the automobile dominates most urban transportation systems. A distribution of vehicle trips is shown here. The automobile accounts for roughly 80% of the total vehicle trips within the average city. The modes of transportation can also be compared using person trips rather than vehicle trips. Person trips shown here are based upon studies in Chicago, Washington, and Detroit. Automobile drivers accounted for the majority of all person trips, with automobile passengers the second largest group. Note the relatively small amount of travel taking place on the public modes. Now that we have a rough idea of how the urban dweller gets about the city, I shall try to say a little about the where of his travels. Person trips are undertaken for many purposes. They involve a variety of origins and destinations. These are frequently grouped into categories. The daily flow pattern for a weekday in Chicago is given in this table. Roughly 10 million trips take place each day. 43% of the trips begin at home and 43% end at home. Within this category, most of the trips ended or started at work. The other large flow involves social recreational trips. The number of triangular trips is fairly small. Apparently, people are not sufficiently inconvenienced by travel to plan ahead to accomplish a multiplicity of missions without going home in between. Next, there's the question of trip length. Here to the traveler at least, the time is more important than the mileage. Here are the frequency distributions of trip lengths for different kinds of trips. The skewed curves indicate larger numbers of short trips and fewer long ones. The average length of a work trip is about 28 minutes. Non-work trips are shorter, only 21 minutes on average. Thus, it seems that the trip purpose has an influence on how far a person is willing to travel. The mode of travel also has an effect on trip length. This table shows suburban railroad users to have the longest average trip, while the shortest trips are made by automobile and bus passengers. This may be hard to believe for the unfortunate long-distance automobile commuter who continually experiences and contributes to traffic jams. Speaking about traffic jams, the weary automobile commuter insists on making things worse by usually trying to travel when the roads are most crowded. This figure shows the hourly percentages of daily trip volume for three modes of travel on an average weekday in Chicago. The rush hour peaks for automobiles are quite evident, but note that they are less pronounced than those for other modes. The sharpest peaks are those for rapid transit and suburban railroad systems. Note that these sharp peaks for public transportation make it difficult for the ACLM to have high utilization effectiveness for these modes. The buses and trains have plenty of empty seats during the non-peak hours. Staggered work hours would do much to lower and spread out the rush hour travel peaks. Transportation planners plead for staggered hours as a means to use transportation facilities, such as roads, rails, and moving stock, more effectively. The costs are multiplied when the system has to be able to handle almost all the traffic during brief rush hour periods. The ACLM might also choose to support this idea of peak spreading. It would be particularly desirable for increasing the utilization effectiveness of mass transit, and full buses use little more energy than empty ones. But staggered hours are no cure-all. The ACLM might also expect automobile emissions to drop as cars did less idling and more over-the-road travel. But increased emissions would be a more likely result in a growing region. More drivers, taking advantage of their staggered work hours, would be tempted to use the roads and to live farther from work. Well, transportation questions could occupy the ACLM full time. It's vital that he integrate transportation considerations with other aspects of land use and air pollution. Much more could be said about the general aspects of urban transportation, but let's get back to the specifics of energy. Transportation, as you recall, is the second largest energy use category. Within this category, nationwide, automobiles account for 55% of the total energy use. Over half of this use is concentrated within urban areas. Urban freight by trucks is also a big chunk of energy. Now, everyone knows the sad story of American railroads for passenger traffic. Passenger miles for railroads are now less than 15% of their 1950 level, and that's why only 0.1% of the energy in the transportation sector is consumed by passenger railroad traffic. Conversely, note air traffic, which continues to increase rapidly. What about energy efficiency? On a vehicle mile basis, the energy requirements of the modes vary widely. If one includes the energy required to keep a human alive, the extra energy for bicycling or for walking is very little indeed, particularly when this incremental energy is compared with that required by some of the mechanized modes. Although we don't suggest that a Chicago to Houston cross-country bicycle trip should be routinely attempted on bicycle or foot, short bike trips of less than 2 miles could be encouraged. We'll tell you how to do it a little bit later. Yes, the bicycle looks good, but we really can't compare the modes using a vehicle mile basis. At least we can say that one person on a bus, one person on a train or a plane, this looks like a loser. So many studies have been published which compare the modes when they are carrying usually unspecified so-called average loads. Objectivity tends to get lost during many of these studies. For example, the proponents of mass transportation will invariably compare an automobile with 1 or 1.3 people in it with a subway train packed full. Here's another way to make the comparison, using a full load or per seat basis. Now we can see that if we could invent some way to fill up our cars, the car would be just as efficient as the bus or the train or even the motorcycle. Well, we chose to avoid the pitfalls of these comparisons by treating the number of passengers as a variable. Another important variable is the fuel economy of the cars. Both variables are included on this graph, where energy per passenger mile is plotted against the number of passengers for several travel alternatives. Let's do that again. You have energy per passenger mile on the abscissa plotted against number of passengers on the ordinate. Here we see that for equivalent energy usage, we can have one person in a 60 mile per gallon vehicle. And that's the same as two people in a 30 mile per gallon vehicle, or six people in a 10 mile per gallon vehicle. Same as 18 people on the bus, or 31 people on the rapid transit car. Air travel is pretty much out of it. Here, the high energy use is supposed to be justified by shortened travel time. The ACLM is more interested in intra-urban transportation than in intercity traffic. Maybe this graph shows that air travel has little place in the urban system. But the ACLM should remember that airports are defined as complex sources, which I discussed in Lecture 1. Airports can be enormous traffic generators and can attract large portions of future urban growth. But let's get back to the graph. Here it becomes clear that several modes other than airplanes can have a place within the urban transportation system. A full subway train looks very good, but even inefficient automobiles are much to be preferred to empty trains. Obviously, the fuller the better. A dozen people on a motorcycle seems unrealistic, even if an ACLM extrapolates our graph to show how efficient this could be. On our graph, the capacities with everyone sitting in seats are shown as solid lines. The standing room is shown by the dashed lines. It should be clear what I'm driving at, and some of you are probably saying unfair. You say, because most computers drive alone. Yes, that's true. But the other modes of transportation never run full at all times either. Even during rush hours, empty or nearly empty buses and trains must return or deadhead to the beginning of the line to pick up more rush hour passengers. The only way to avoid this is to settle for one trip in and one trip out each day. And of course, such a system would make capital costs for mass transit even higher than they are already. The necessary multiple trips make it unlikely that any public mode can average more than a 50% load factor. In the car's favor, at least, it does indeed make that one trip in and one trip out each commuting day. Now, policymakers haven't been very successful in getting more people to use mass transit. Perhaps the ACLM would do better by trying to increase the number of people in a car. Our aim here is not to favor one mode over another, but to try to show the ACLM that no single mode is the complete answer. In particular, complete substitution of mass transit for cars would probably be a very inefficient policy, unless people were concentrated in a few specific residential areas. And even then, most of them would have to work in the same central business district. The automobile provides very desirable flexibility, and present land use patterns seem to require such flexibility. We feel that the ACLM should learn to live with the automobile and should attack the present shortcomings of the automobile mode. And that is, let's develop urban vehicles which are smaller, more economical, and less polluting. Even large numbers of mass transit buses or trains could not provide the same flexibility even if they ran empty most of the time. Empty trains, as the figure indicated, are not a plus. Also, where desirable and feasible, in certain central business districts, let's go all the way and ban automobiles completely, at least when the cost-benefit analysis shows this to be the appropriate alternative. Remember that Mrs. Chu's cost-benefit analysis in Lecture 2 indicated that stringent 1975 level emission controls on Los Angeles vehicles was not a very cost-effective solution. It isn't a good solution from an energy standpoint either. My remarks shouldn't be taken to mean that the ACLM should forever endure the present not pleasant. Automobile-dominated modal split. Travelers can be switched to more efficient, less polluting modes, and overall travel demand can be reduced. For example, much more could be done to promote walking and bicycling for short-length trips. Most trips are less than 5 miles in length. Interestingly, it's these short trips with those cold engine starts and low operating temperatures which are responsible for most automotive emissions. Any switching away from automobiles would show up as direct energy and multiply emission reductions. In order to achieve this switch, the ACLM should develop appropriate incentives for personal locomotion. Such incentives could be constructing attractive walkways or bicycle paths, rest or recreational areas, shelters, and even covered walkways. Sadly, at times, we seem to be moving in the opposite direction. Many suburban areas have now eliminated sidewalks completely, thus assuring utter and complete dependence on the automobile. Here's another place where building codes deserve some revision. Also in new suburban areas, the ACLM could decrease the need for transportation by promoting more nearby recreation facilities. Leisure time activities are becoming increasingly important reasons for trip generation. Note that I've stopped short of suggesting that high-density living is the answer. Residences, commercial activities, and industry could all be clumped together so as to entirely eliminate the need for most travel. That is, we could try to recreate the pedestrian city with quite a few more people per square mile. In Lecture 6, you will see why this approach is probably not a good idea. As a preview, keep in mind that when emissions are index-weighted, transportation need not be the largest category. Up till now, I've emphasized people transportation, but a considerable amount of energy is also used to move goods. Urban trucking alone consumes over 15% of nationwide transportation energy. From an energy standpoint, there are more efficient alternatives. As you can see on this energy per ton mile comparison. Now, pipelines and waterways may not always be feasible, but efforts should be made to keep heavy, bulky freight on rails rather than in trucks. The rail beltway was a suggestion made in Lecture 3. Well, we have one more topic. During this lecture, I've been intimating that energy use reductions are synonymous with air quality improvements. And this can be true, but only up to a point. We know, for example, that use of smaller engines on smaller vehicles could reduce both energy consumption and emissions. However, use of most emission control devices on cars would result in reduced emissions only at the expense of higher energy use. What I'm getting to is that energy comparisons between modes are useful and meaningful, but we can also compare modes from a pollution standpoint. Here's a comparison of the index-weighted emissions on a vehicle-mile basis. The bus looks much better from a pollution standpoint than from an energy standpoint. This conclusion is reinforced by this passenger-mile comparison. In defense of the car, it should be noted that expenditures for emission control equipment could make even the single passenger car competitive from an emission standpoint. 1975 level controls would cut the index weighted emissions of the car down to the level of the bus. Thus, I leave the ACLM with a fascinating trade-off, one between energy and emissions, between emission control equipment and mode, not to mention the number of people on the vehicle. Well, hold off on your cost-benefit analysis, because the Pindex tables are based upon emissions, while damages must also consider source-receptor relationships. And source-receptor relationships are affected by meteorology. And meteorology and dispersion modeling are the subjects of our next lecture. Thank you.